Hello friends, how are you? You must be doing great. I am Prashant and welcome to the new initiative of Next IAS YouTube channel. Now through this initiative, we will analyze the civil services prelims exams previous year question papers. I'll be covering the economy part. So when we analyze these questions, we'll try to find out the source of the question, then the approach to solve that particular question. Like what kind of approach can we use, whether there is some kind of trick that we can use, whether there can be some kind of intelligent guesswork. Often we use intelligent guesswork when we solve the UPSC prelims questions, right? So we'll try to see that, whether there can be any kind of use of existing knowledge base that we can do. See, for one particular question, we may not be knowing all the information, but whatever information I have, can I use that information for solving that question and arriving the correct answer? Let's see that. And fourth thing we'll see is the risk analysis. Now, when I say risk analysis, by risk analysis, I mean whether if I don't know anything about that particular question, shall I solve that question or shall I not? Whether I should use the intelligent guesswork there or not. So that is called as a risk analysis. And of course, we are going to discuss the related concepts that are there in the question. So why should I or why should you analyze the UPSC previous year questions? That's the question, isn't it? So what sort of questions does UPSC ask? That we'll come to know if we actually analyze the UPSC previous year questions. We'll also come to know the source of question. Now, once we know the source of question, we know the diversification of the sources that UPSC does. And that acts as a guide for us to basically refer some particular sources for that particular topic, isn't it? And third thing is the approach for studying. It develops an approach for studying. We'll come to know what topics are important, what topics are not important. When I read a particular page, I'll come to know on what line shall I emphasize, shall I not emphasize, isn't it? Because we must remember one thing, effort is important, but knowing where to make an effort makes all the difference. Effort is important, but knowing where to make an effort makes all the difference, right? So let's start with our first question. So our first question is, with reference to Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, consider the following statements. AIIB has more than 80 member nations. AIIB is the largest shareholder India is the largest shareholder in AIIB. And AIIB does not have any members from outside Asia. Now see, this is again a current affairs based question, a factual question. So if you don't really know about AIIB and all about any of these options, then it is very difficult to solve this. But if you see properly, let's say you haven't read anything specifically regarding this particular bank, but if you are reading newspapers, then you will certainly know certain things about the AIIB, isn't it? So first thing and very basic thing about this bank is this is a China-led initiative. Okay. Whenever there is a China-led initiative and China is a part of any kind of multilateral institute, it is very difficult or it is very unlikely that India is the largest shareholder in AIIB, isn't it? So in that case, we may eliminate the second option or second statement. So this way we can eliminate the option B and option D. Now from option 1A and option C, we can choose the right answer. So AIIB does not have any members from outside Asia. Wrong. It has members from outside Asia. So that's why our answer will be A. So Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, this is a bank with a mission to improve the social and economic outcomes in Asia, headquartered in Beijing. Try to understand one thing, AIIB has headquartered in Beijing. Asian Development Bank is headquartered in Manila. And New Development Bank, which is also called as the BRICS Bank, it is headquartered in Shanghai. So it has 102 approved members worldwide. The largest shareholder is of course China. India is the second largest shareholder. And Russia is the third largest shareholder. This is something you should remember. It has non-regional members. Non-regional members means members which are outside the Asia. Those are Germany, Canada, UK, Sweden, Egypt, and there are many more. Okay. In fact, non-regional members hold 23% of its shares. And among the non-regional members, Germany is the largest shareholder. Fine. So next go to the, now we will go to the next question. What was the purpose of inter-creditor agreement signed by Indian banks and financial institutions recently? Now again, when it says recently, then it means it is from the current affairs. So basically this inter-creditor agreement was signed for resolution of bad assets or stress assets. Okay, so that's why our option D will be correct, to aim at faster resolution of stress asset of Rs 50 crore or more which are under consortium lending. So this inter-creditor agreement was basically a part of Project Sashakt. This Project Sashakt was proposed by Sunil Mehta committee. So this Project Sashakt was proposed for resolution of stressed asset. So what it proposed? It proposed that bad loans of up to 50 crore shall be managed at bank level. Bad loans that are between 50 crores to 500 crores, for that the bank should enter the inter-creditor agreement. That is, the banks will have agreement among themselves, there will be a lead bank among themselves, and then they'll decide what kind of resolution shall be done for that particular asset. Okay. And for loans above 500 crore, the panel recommended asset management company. So the answer here is the option D. Now the next question is regarding again public sector banks. So the chairman of public sector bank are selected by, again this is from current affairs. Okay. Now understand one thing, the selection and appointment may be considered as two different terms. Selection is done by one particular body, and other particular body will have the say for the appointment of that particular person. So of course the answer is Bank Board Bureau. Bank Board Bureau is just a recommendary body, will just recommend a person for the chairman of particular public sector bank. It is up to the finance ministry to select that person or not, or to appoint that person or not. So this is basically, this Bank Board of Bureau is a part of Indradhanush plan or Indradhanush mission aimed at revamping the public sector banks. So it's an autonomous recommendary body which was constituted in 2016. See, one of the function of Bank Board of Bureau is to select the heads of public sector banks. Must remember one thing, this Bank Board of Bureau is only related to public sector banks and not private banks. The other functions include the assistance for the public sector bank to restructure their business strategies, assistance to public sector banks regarding resolution of bad loans, to give them the new innovative mechanism for raising capitals. So these are the different or other functions of the Bank Board Bureau. Now Vinod Rai was its first chairman, was very famous Comptroller and Auditor General of India. Vinod Rai was his first chairman, and current chairman is Bhanu Pratap Sharma. Now next question is regarding the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index. What does this question ask? It says, which one of the following is not a sub-index of World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index? Now there should be a proper reading over here. He is asking which is not a sub-index of World Bank's Ease of Doing Business. Okay. Now UPSC frequently asks these questions. It asks you about the report, and it asks you about the publisher of that particular report, or it will give you certain kind of index. It will give, let's say, HDI, and then it will say who publishes that particular HDI. But this time it has gone one step further, and it is asking us about the sub-index of that particular index. It is asking about the sub-indices of the particular index. So this gives us a clue that what should we study next time when we study one particular index on one particular report. We should also know the sub-indices of that particular index, isn't it? So here the option will be maintenance of law and order. Now, if you don't know these particular things, or four options or those sub-indices, it is better not to guess this. Okay, it is better not to guess that. So World Bank's Ease of Doing Business, this particular index, this is World Bank's index. India was ranked 77th in 2019, and it has 10 different sub-indices or 10 different parameters on which it basically calculates that particular index, that is Ease of Doing Business index. So among those 10 those parameters, we don't have maintenance of law and order. That's why our option will be A. Fine. Now next question. The economic cost of food grains to the Food Corporation of India is minimum support price and bonus paid to farmers plus. And then it has given us four options. Okay. Now, this is again from a basic question, isn't it? If you have read about the Food Corporation of India, its different cost it associated with, you may be able to solve this question, isn't it? So, Food Corporation India, it is a statutory body that was established in 1965 under Food Corporation Act. Now, Food Corporation of India's function is to purchase, store, move, transport and distribute the food grains across the India, right? So, during its process, that is right from purchasing till the distribution of food grains, it incurs certain cost. And that total cost is called as the economic cost of food grains for Food Corporation of India. Okay. So, that total cost will be minimum support price and bonus plus procurement incidentals and distribution cost. So, answer will be C here, procurement incidentals and distribution costs. We'll try to see what is this procurement incidentals and distribution cost. Okay. So, you see the economic cost that is there for the FCI. Now, economic cost will include procurement cost. Procurement cost means what? See, the FCI, they'll purchase this food grain, they have to transport it, there will be certain labor charges, certain taxes. So, these are all comes under the procurement cost. Procurement price, on the other hand, will be your MSP plus if bonus any paid. And third will be distribution cost. Now, when it has procured, it has to distribute also. Once it distributed to states, then it has certain charges regarding that. That a storage charges will be there, the interest charges will be there, there will be certain losses during transportation. So, these all are the distribution cost. These three cost combined together will form the economic cost. Now, you see this option D here, the procurement incidentals plus charges for godowns. Of course, the charges for godowns are included in economic cost, but those are not the only charges. These are one of the only charges from distribution cost. Distribution cost will include many other charges also, and one charge from this is a charge from godown. So, that's why option D will not be there. So, option C is right option for us. Now, next question is regarding the service area approach. So, service area approach was implemented under the purview of Integrated Rural Program, Lead Bank Scheme, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme and National Skill Development Mission. Now, if you have read regarding the money and banking, if you have read regarding certain things regarding the banking history in India, then you must be knowing the lead bank scheme. And right answer is the lead bank scheme over here. So, again, this comes from the static part of the Indian economy. The service area approach was implemented under the purview of lead bank scheme. Now, let's see what is lead bank scheme and what is service area approach. So, this lead bank scheme was basically there for providing adequate banking and credit services in rural areas. Okay. So, what is the lead bank here? So, lead bank was one particular bank which had better network of banking and its branches in one particular district. So, for one district, there was one lead bank. Once that lead bank was designated, then under its leadership, they were supposed to carry out the, or other also other banks are supposed to carry out the banking and credit operations in the rural areas. Okay. So, in 1989, under lead bank scheme, they had introduced what is called as the service area approach. So, under service area approach, what did they do? Each branch, and this each branch of the particular bank was assigned 15 to 25 villages. And then, so that was basically a service area for that particular branch. Okay. So, 15 to 25 villages were assigned and that became a service area for that particular branch of that bank. Okay. And that branch was supposed to serve that area in a better way, especially for the penetration of bank credit in that area. So, that is called as a service area approach. Consider the following statements. Most of India's external debt is owned by government entities and all of India's external debt is denominated in US dollars. Now, again, this is a totally factual question. You should know about the trends of the external debt that only you will be able to solve these questions. Okay. So, it is advisable that if you don't know anything about this, it's better to leave this question, not to guess anything. But still, if you want to guess, then See statement 2. All of India's external debt is denominated in US dollars. Now, this seems quite unlikely. This India's external debt is actually denominated in different currencies. So, that's why this seems quite unlikely. So, we can say that statement 2 is wrong. Okay. So, only then we have to see what about the statement 1. Fine. So, here the most of India's external debt is owed by government entity. This is wrong. Most of India's external debt is external commercial borrowings by private entities. And all of India's external debt is denominated in US dollars. This is again wrong. Largest part is in US dollars, but there are other currencies also in which this particular debt is denominated. Fine. So, this is Department of Economic Affairs report of December 2019. Of course, when this question was asked, it was asked in June 2019. So, you should be knowing trends before that. But overall, the trends are same. That's why I have taken the report of Department of Economic Affairs that is at the end of December 2019. So, see, external commercial borrowings, these are the largest component of India's external debt. Then, the in terms of denomination or denominated debt, you see, largest share is of US dollars. Okay. Second largest is Indian rupee. Third one is yen. And then SDR. So, you should know this also, that largest share is denominated in terms of US dollars, then Indian rupees, then yen, and then special drawing rights. So, now this yen and special drawing rights position may be changed, right? But overall, the largest debt is in terms of US dollars and then Indian rupee. Now, certain facts that I have taken from economic survey. So, India's external debt overall is lower. Like external debt to GDP ratio of India is lower than other developing countries. For other developing countries, on an average, it is 25.6%. For India, it is around 20%. Right? So, both the statements in this question are wrong. Which one of the following is not included in assets of commercial bank in India? Again, read it properly. It is asking which is not included in assets of commercial bank in India. That's what it is asking. Which one of the following is actually a liability of commercial bank in India. This is an easy question. Basic. If you read the macroeconomics NCRT, you will be able to solve this particular question. So, all it is asking is which one of the following is the liability of banks. Now, for banks, deposits are the liability, right? Because deposits are something that banks do not own. They have to give it back to their customers. So, that's why they are liabilities for that. They are not assets. So, that's why option B is right. Now, what are the assets that bank have? So, assets are basically that are owned by banks, or banks are going to get those back, right? So, loans and advances are assets. The second largest asset is investment, then money and call and short notice, cash in hand, the cash held with RBI, like banks hold some cash with RBI in terms of CRR. So, that is also asset for bank. Money at call and short notice, what is this? This is basically short-term loans given by the banks. Then bill discounts and discounted and purchase. So, these are all the assets of the banks. Fine. Now, liabilities include deposits that banks have, both time and demand deposits, and certain borrowings of the banks. Because even when banks borrow from outside, they have to give it back to them. Fine. So, these are two are the liabilities. Now, in context of India, which of the following factor is our contributor to the reducing risk of currency crisis? So, basically, it is asking in order which are the following factors. There are three factors they have given that actually contribute to reducing the risk of currency crisis. Okay. What is currency crisis? Currency crisis is basically depreciation or decline in value of a particular currency. Let's say depreciation, decline in value of currency happens below certain level, then we can say there is currency crisis. So, in such crisis, which of the following will reduce the risk of such crisis? That's what it is asking. Okay. Now, the foreign currency earnings of IT sector, of course, they will reduce the risk. This is an easy conceptual question which you should be able to solve, right? Foreign currency earnings of IT sector, remittances from India from abroad, when they will flow in India, both of these earnings from both, from remittances also and foreign currency earnings also, there is less chances that currency will depreciate, or at least it will not contribute to depreciation of currency. And even if currency depreciates, then this foreign currency earnings and these remittances can be used by the central bank for injecting that particular money in foreign exchange market, that forex in the foreign exchange market, so that demand for the rupee increases and demand for the foreign exchange will reduce. So that appropriation can be carried out by using this forex. So that's why it reduces that risk of currency crisis. But what about this? So that's why our answer is B. What about the second option, increasing the government expenditure? C. When government expenditure increases, it increases the domestic demand. When domestic demand increases, it increases the demand for import. When demand for import increases, of course, the demand for foreign currency will increase and domestic currency will reduce. So that might lead to the depreciation or decline of the value of your currency. That may lead to the currency crisis. Fine. So our answer is basically B. Which of the following is issued by registered foreign portfolio investor to overseas investors who want to be part of Indian stock market without registering themselves directly? And then it has given four instruments in the options. Okay. So basically this question is asking that if some foreign investor wants to invest in Indian share market, but he doesn't want to register in Indian share market, then which of the following instrument can be used for this? Okay. So again, this is an easy basic question. If you know these four type of instrument, you can easily answer this. The answer will be participatory notes. Let's not confuse between participatory note and promissory notes. What are participatory notes? Participatory notes are basically offshore derivative investment or instruments. Derivative means their value is there, or their value is derived from certain other asset. And here the assets are Indian shares. So basically these foreign portfolio investors, they will issue the participatory notes based on shares of Indian companies in Indian short market. So any foreign investor can buy those participatory notes. It's like he's buying it, which means he's investing in Indian shares, because Indian shares are underlying assets there. Fine. So this is how, through participatory note, any foreign portfolio investor, any foreign investor, overseas investor can invest in India without registering in with SEBI. Now there are other concepts here, like what is promissory note then? So promissory note is basically financial instrument that contains a written promise for certain payback of money or paying back of money. For example, a person A or company A wants to take loan from company B. Then company A, what will it do? It will give the promissory note to company B or to an individual B. Then that individual B will give to loan it to you. That promissory note will contain a promise that it will, that individual A will be giving back money to individual B. Fine. So this way the companies can raise the finance from sources other than bank. Okay. So that is what is the promissory note. What are commercial paper? Now commercial paper again is a debt instrument, short term debt instrument, which is unsecured and through which the debt or the money is raised by the corporations or private entities. Now commercial paper is also sort of again promissory note. They will give commercial paper to that person who gives them loan, and that commercial paper will be, certain things will be written that when that money will be given back by the corporation. So that is also debt instrument and type of promissory note. Certificate of deposit, again it's a promissory note. Certificate of deposit basically is a instrument which is fixed, which has fixed maturity date and fixed interest rate. But this certificate of deposits are issued by commercial bank and financial institutes. So when you deposit money to the bank, they will issue you certificate of deposit. Now they have shorter maturity period of 7 days to 1 year. That is for commercial bank, and for financial institutes, it is 1 to 3 years. So certificate of deposits also sort of promissory notes. Now this question is regarding India's 5-year plans. With reference to India's 5-year plans, which of the following statements are correct? And then they have given 3 statements regarding second 5-year plan, fourth 5-year plan and fifth 5-year plan. Now this is totally a factual question. This is, you should know about the India's 5-year plans, then only you will be able to solve this question. So it is advisable, if you don't know anything about it, don't guess it. But here the statement 1 is something that is easier than the statement 2 and 3. What does statement 1 say? From second 5-year plan, there was determined thrust towards substitution of basic and capital good industries. Now, most of the people who have read something about planning will know that second 5-year plan was based on Nehru-Malnobis model or Nehru-Malnobis plan. And that plan was based on the heavy industrial bias, where they wanted to establish basic and capital good industries rather than wage good industries in India. So, in that way, we can say that from second year flying plan, there was determined thrust towards substitution of basic and capital goods industries. So, this particular statement is right. Fine. Now, don't confuse this, don't get confused because of this word substitution. Here, word substitution does not mean substitution of basic and capital good industries with other industries. Here, substitution means import substitution. Like if you are importing basic and capital goods from other countries, we'll substitute those imports with our domestic production. So, that is called as a substitution. Okay. So, basically those imports are substituted by the basic and capital good industry that is established in our country. So, statement 1 is right. What about statement 2? Fourth 5-year plan. So, fourth 5-year plan adopted an objective of correcting the earlier trends of increased concentration of wealth and economic power. That is also right. See, fourth 5-year plan says that there were earlier trends which basically helped to certain sections of agriculture and industry only. Now, they wanted to make some corrective action. How? They wanted to promote, we can say, sort of inclusive growth, where they will focus more on the weaker sections now and assist the less prosperous sections of farming population. Right? So, even second statement is right. Third statement is wrong, because fifth 5-year plan was not the first plan where the financial sector was included as integral part of the plan. Fine. So, third statement is wrong. So, the option is A. In fact, fifth 5-year plan's main objective was to contain the inflation and reduce the poverty. Now, next question is regarding purchasing power parity. Consider the following statements. Purchasing power parity exchange rates are calculated by comparing prices of same baskets of goods and services in different countries. In terms of PPP dollars, India is the sixth largest economy in the world. Relatively easy question. Why? Because purchasing power parity, this concept, you should be knowing as a basic concept in the economy. So, of course, purchasing power parity exchange rates are calculated by comparing the prices of same baskets of goods and services in different countries. That is right. In terms of PPP dollars, India is the sixth largest economy in the world. Now, if you read the newspapers, okay, even if you read, see some kind of TV debate, you will come to know that India is actually third largest economy in terms of PPP dollars, not sixth. So, statement second is wrong. Okay. So, now the option A is correct. What is purchasing power parity? So, basically it's an economic theory that allows us to compare the purchasing powers of the different currencies in the world. Okay. So, it tells us that one particular basket of goods or similar basket of goods, how much does that similar basket of goods cost in different countries? For example, if I say 1 kg of apple, how much does 1 kg of apple cost in different countries? So, what is purchasing power parity exchange rate? See, purchasing power parity exchange rate is the rate at which currency of the one country can be converted into currency of other country to buy the same amount of goods and services in each country. Purchasing power parity exchange rate is basically rate at which currency of one country is converted into the currency of another country to buy the same amount of goods and services in each country. For example, if you have 1 kg of apple, okay, now 1 kg of apple cost you $2 in US, okay, and this same 1 kg of apple cost you 100 rupees in country like India. So, what will be the, for 1 kg of apple, we have to give 100 rupees in India and $2 in US. So, how will you calculate the exchange rate here? Now, we have same amount of goods and services in each country, that is apples. So, how will you calculate the conversion rate here? So, that conversion rate will be 100 by 2, that is 50. So, 50 rupees for $1 is the exchange rate here. So, now we have calculated the exchange rate by using the same amount of goods and services here. So, that's how the purchasing power exchange rate works. Fine. So, for this question, the answer will be A. Now, you see, in terms of PPP, China is the largest economy in the world. Second largest is United States and third largest is India. Now, in terms of nominal GDP, if you see, not in terms of PPV, USA is the largest economy in the world. China is second, Japan is third, Germany is fourth. And now India has become the fifth largest economy. In terms of nominal GDP, India has become the fifth largest economy. It has surpassed UK recently. Fine. Among the agricultural commodities imported by India, which one of the following accounts for the highest import in terms of value in last 5 years? Now, it is asking imports in terms of value and not in terms of volume. That we should know one first thing. That we should note here, that value in last 5 years. Totally factual question. The answer will be vegetable oils. So, this is annual report of Department of Commerce from which I have taken this. So, vegetable oils is the largest commodity that in terms of value that is imported in India in last 5 years. Then it is pulses, you should know this, and then fresh fruits. Now, what about agricultural exports in India? Now, economic survey says that India's agricultural export basket accounts for 2.15% of world's agricultural trade. We should know this fact, that it is around 2.15% of world agricultural trade. India's agriculture basket accounts for 2.15% of world agricultural trade. There could be a question on this, like India's export basket accounts for the 20% of world agricultural trade, right or wrong, right? So that's why we should know this, we should have some idea regarding the composition of India's export. So major export destination for India's agricultural goods is USA, then Saudi Arabia, then Iran, Nepal and Bangladesh. And India is also net exporter of agri products. It means India exports more value of agri products than it actually imports. Fine. And that has been a consistent since 1991 reforms, if you see. Now, what is the largest exported commodity in terms of value in India? That is rice, basmati rice, agricultural commodity we are talking about. Then spices, then rice other than basmati rice. Fine. Now, let's see the next question. Which one of the following is not the most likely measure the government or RBI takes to stop the slide of Indian rupee? So it is asking that the Indian rupees might depreciate, or it will, the value of Indian rupees will decline. In that case, government of RBI will take certain steps to stop such decline or slide of Indian rupee. However, the question is asking which of the following measure will not be taken by RBI or government to stop the slide of Indian rupees. Okay. It is not asking that measures that should be taken or that will be taken by the RBI or government. It is asking which of the measures are not taken, or which are the measures are not, which one of the following measure is not the most likely measure that RBI will take to stop the slide of Indian rupee. Now, what is the first option? Curbing imports of non-essential goods and promoting export. See, if I curb the import of non-essential goods and promote the export, it means my value of my currency will increase. It will not depreciate. Currency will not depreciate. So, this is the measure that actually RBI or government will take to slide the, to stop the slide of Indian rupee. So, this is not our answer, because we are trying to find out the option that will not be pursued by RBI or government. Okay. Second thing is encouraging Indian borrowers to issue rupee denominated masala bonds. See, masala bonds are quite in use nowadays. So, if rupee denominated masala bonds are issued, it means the risk of the currency appreciation or depreciation lies with the investor, not by with the issuer. So, now when such kind of bonds will be issued, if those, there will be more subscription in these bonds, then more currency will come to India. It means there will be, it will help in stopping the slide of Indian rupee. So, of course, this is not our answer. Now, easing conditions relating to external commercial borrowings. Of course, when we ease the condition regarding the ECBs or external commercial borrowings, more foreign exchange will come to India. That will stop the slide of Indian rupee. So, this is not our option. So, if we are railing three, then of course, fourth should be the option. So, following an expansionary monetary policy. So, if I follow the expansionary monetary policy, what will happen? Let's say RBI reduces repo rate. What will happen? It will give more money to banks. So, banks will reduce their interest rate. This way, more money in the hands of people, with the industries, the demand will increase. When demand increases, of course, it will increase the demand for foreign goods also. So import will increase. When import will increase, it means there is possibility that rupee will depreciate. So this is not something, this measure will not be taken by RBI. So that is our answer. Fine. So this was easy question based on certain fundamentals of economics. Next question. The Reserve Bank of India's recent directive relating to storage of payment system data, popularly known as the data dictate, command the payment systems providers that, and then it has given us three statements. So which of these three statements are actually part of that directive? That's what it is asking. So what is the storage of payment system data? See, whatever transactions we do, whatever online transactions we do regarding payments, for each transaction there will be certain data that is stored. Now regarding the storage of this payment system data, Reserve Bank had given certain directives in April 2018 under Payment and Settlement Systems Act. So what is the first statement? That they shall ensure that entire data relating to payment system operated by them are stored in systems only in India. This is right. This was the part of directive. Now this was a current affairs based question. This is a part of directive, so we should know. This is factual. Okay. So they shall ensure that systems are owned and operated by public sector enterprise. No such directive was there. So this is wrong. They shall submit their consolidated system audit report to CAG of India or CAG of India. So again, this is wrong. They are supposed to submit this report to RBI and not the CAG. So our answer is A here. So this particular directive was issued in 2018 under Payment and Systems Act. Okay. So, and that they were supposed to comply this directive within 6 months. Next question. The money multiplier in an economy increases with which of the following? And then it has given us four options. Now, money multiplier is a concept. If you know the basic macroeconomics, if you read the basic macroeconomics book of NCERT book, you can easily solve this question. What is money multiplier basically? So, money multiplier is basically the ratio of stock of the money in the economy to the high powered money. Okay. So high powered money in the economy will be less, then there will be a process of money creation through this high powered money, and that will be then increase, that will increase the total money supply in the economy. So this ratio of total money supply in the economy to the high powered money is called as a money multiplier. Fine. So what is the process of money creation and all that we can again discuss in some other video. Right now you just remember that through this money creation, the money supply in the economy will increase. So basically, if money creation is more, it means value of money multiplier is more. So with the same amount of high powered money, if you are able to create more money and if you are able to create the increase the more money supply in the economy, then value of money multiplier is more. Now also money multiplier is inversely proportional to varying reserve requirements. Okay, what are varying reserve requirements? Let's say cash reserve ratio, statutory liquidity ratio, these are varying reserve requirements. If I increase the CRR, there will be less money with the banks. So with this less money with the banks, there will be less money creation because banks will be lending less. Fine. So that's why the value of money multiplier decreases with the increasing varying reserve requirements. And value of money creation, if money creation increases, then more value of, there will be more value of money multiplier. Now once we know this, then we go to our options. You see, increase in the cash reserve ratio, of course, when you, as I told you, this is inversely proportional to money multiplier. So this is wrong. Money multiplier in the economy increases with the increase in statutory liquidity ratio, wrong. Fine. With the increasing banking habit of the population, see, when banking habit of the population increases, then of course population will get its services more from banks. So it will deposit money with the bank, then it will take loan from the bank. So with the same deposits, more loan will be given to the people. From that same loan, people will earn more, they will deposit back to the bank. Then again, that money will be given as a loan to people. So this way, money creation may happen. And when money creation happens, what happens? Your money multiplier value increases. So your option B is right. Now what about option D? Increase in population of country. See, increase in population of country does not necessarily mean that your money multiplier or value of money increase, because increase in population of country does not necessarily ensure that the banking habit of population will increase. Even if population of country is more, people may not go to banks. Fine. So that's why, or even if population of country is more, banks may not lend more. So that's why more appropriate answer is increasing banking habit of the population. Next question. The global competitive report, the global competitiveness report is published by the, again, it's very easy answer. It is published by the World Economic Forum. This is frequently in news. So World Economic Forum is basically a non-profit organization that was established in 1970 based on the public-private cooperation. So it basically arranges different forums of different political business leaders for different agendas. So this World Economic Forum publishes what is called as the Global Competitiveness Report. Now this Global Competitiveness Report also has Global Competitiveness Index, right? So India was ranked 68th in Global Competitiveness Index in 2019. So this Global Competitiveness Index basically sees the competitive landscapes of a nation. It evaluates that landscape or productive competitive landscape of the nation on 12 pillars or 12 factors. What are those factors? Institutions, infrastructure, ICT adaptation, macroeconomic stability, health, and other factors. There are 12 factors. So we should have some idea of these factors also, because as we saw, that sub-indices have already also asked by the UPSC now. Fine. In a given year in India, official poverty lines are higher in some states than in others because. Now again, this is based on the basics, fundamentals regarding poverty lines. This is a beautiful question actually. It seems easier, but the options are quite confusing here. If you don't know the certain basic regarding poverty line, you may not be able to solve this question right. The answer here is the official poverty lines in India are higher in some state than in other state because price levels vary from state to state. How? See, what is poverty line? So poverty line is basically benchmark which decides which people are poor, which people are not poor. Who is poor and who is not poor? For example, the poverty line is set at 1000 rupees by government. Then those earning less than 1000 rupees are poor. Those who are not earning, earning more than 1000 rupees are not poor. So this is the concept of poverty line. But this poverty line is not decided only in terms of money every time. This can be also decided in terms of consumption of goods and services. So in India, how we decide the poverty line? In India, the poverty line is basically the money, minimum money required for maintaining the capita income of intake of 2100 calories and 2400 calories in rural area and 2100 calories in urban area. So anyone who is not able to earn this minimum money that is required for the intake of this many calories is called as the poor, and who is able to earn that much money is called as the he is not considered as a poor according to the poverty line in India. Fine. So basically, but you see here, in order to consume these many calories, the particular person has to buy certain goods and services, some grains he has to buy, some vegetables he has to buy, and then that minimum money will decide your poverty line. Fine. But then these prices of these goods and services for grains, for wheat, for rice, that will vary state to state. Like wheat might be cheaper in the states where it is produced more. Rice might be cheaper in the states, it produced more, and it will be costlier in the other state. So that's why the minimum money required for buying that will also vary. And that's why poverty line vary. So that is the answer here. Fine. Consider the following statement. Coal sector was nationalized by Government of India under Indira Gandhi. Now coal blocks are allocated on lottery basis. Till recently, India imported coal to meet shortages of domestic supply, but now India is self-sufficient in coal production. Now, this is a factual one based on current affairs, based on even static, but this is easier question. If you see, it is saying till recently, India imported coal, but now it doesn't import. That's what the statement 3 is saying, India is self-sufficient. If you read the news, you will come to know that India is not self-sufficient. Also, it is a very extreme statement that we are not importing coal at all. See, even if you have more coal in India, there is possibility that we will still be importing it because of the quality of coal that we have in India, because of the overall total production of coal in India. So that's why the statement 3 seems wrong. So if you are able to understand that statement 3 is wrong, then we can actually easily eliminate this 3. And only option A is correct. So here we can effectively use the elimination method. Also, if you see second statement, coal blocks are allocated on lottery basis. No, they are auctioned in India. We know the coal scam, the Supreme Court judgment when the coal blocks allocation was cancelled. And after that, then we had this Coal Mines Special Provision Act 2015. Then there is this National Mineral Policy. All of them talk about the allocation of coal mines by way of auction. So, of course, second is wrong. What about first one? Coal sector was nationalized during 1971 to 1973. Of course, Indira Gandhi was Prime Minister back then. So that's why statement A is correct and option A is correct here. Among the following, which one is the largest exporter of rice in the world in last 5 years? Totally a factual question. And the answer is India. India is the largest exporter of rice in last 5 years. Okay, that is the thing to cherish, of course. And since 2014-18, if you see, India's share in world rice export is around 25 to 26%. Second largest exporter is Thailand and third one is Vietnam. So this way we are able to discuss the economy questions. We have discussed the economic questions of this 2019 prelims question paper of UPSC. What we have learned from this? Understand 2-3 things. If you see the pattern of this paper, you understand that there are many questions for which you need the understanding of fundamentals. For example, we had a question regarding PPP, then economic cost, then we had this currency crisis questions. So if you know the fundamentals, then you can solve these questions. Second thing, you should also be reading newspapers because there are certain answers that you could have given if you are reading the current affairs or if you are reading the newspapers. Also, current affairs were not only from 2019, they were also from 2018 also. So your coverage of current affairs should be wider. Third thing is there are certain questions which were factual questions. 2 or 3 questions were there in which it was very difficult to guess. So I'll advise in such questions, it's better to leave this question, not to answer them, because if they go wrong, anyways, we are taking risk in other questions. We have seen that. But in those questions, if they go wrong, then in that case, you might end up having more negative marks. So that's all from my side. Hope you are doing good in the corona times. Stay healthy, stay strong. Thanks.